Ladies and gentlemen, our next session is a book launch, and the title of the book is A History of the Judiciary in Pakistan by Hamid Khan. The speakers for this session are Ijaz Hussain, Faisal Siddiqui, Hamid Khan, and Nasra Iqbal. The moderator for the session is Ijaz Shafi Gilani. Over to Ijaz, sir.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Thank you, everyone, for coming. It's a pleasure. The author in particular and our three commentators. I've brought the book with me so you can also visually see it. It's a thick book, about 550 pages, with 20 chapters. And I'm not a lawyer myself, but I asked my son, who is a lawyer, how many chief justices have been there since Pakistan's inception? And he said, Justice Iftikhar Chaudhary was the 20th. So the book also has 20 chapters, which means that every chief justice of Pakistan, since the first one, Chief Justice Abdul Rashid, has been mentioned in great and fair detail. Every Chief Justice of Pakistan, from the first one up until when the book concludes, Justice Iftikhar Chaudhary, has been mentioned from a very readable life sketch of the Chief Justice, which generally comes at the end of each chapter. The conditions under which the Chief Justice began their work, the political conditions during that time, and their major decisions. But despite all of this, the book does not look pedantic. It's a readable book. It's a very readable book. In many ways, a refreshing change from the books on Pakistan's political history. There was a time when we used to say that there are not enough books on Pakistan's political history. But in recent years, there maybe has been an overdose of books on Pakistan's political history and security history. A few also on the economic history or economics. But the judiciary, which is so important in the politics of the country, being a major institution of governance, has almost totally been ignored. So in that sense, when I began with it, I thought, like many other books in political history, it would take a few hours to skim through it and I would understand what it has. Because there is so much redundancy in recent books on Pakistan's political history. This is a book about the same period, but it took several days for me to read it because each chapter brought new information and new insights. So it has great breadth from 1947 up until 2013. Also a great deal of depth because it analyzes all of the important cases during each Chief Justice's period. What makes it readable is insights where it blends judiciary with political circumstances of the time and its political consequences. And that would not come except for deep insight into the political as well as other aspects. And finally, what makes it most readable, and I think boldly, is opinions. So Hamid Khan Sahib does not shy away from giving very bold and open opinions, but not malicious. It does not mince any words, as I found in this, making it readable, but at the same time is not malicious. He has a few heroes and a few villains, but even when it comes to heroes and villains, he balances it because every hero has certain flaws, including his hero, Justice Cornelius. At the end, he mentions he joined Yahya Khan's cabinet and always had a remorse about it. or his villains like Justice Munir, where he also narrates some of the accomplishments which he did make. But if it comes to corruption or doing nothing, then he's extremely harsh about it. So each chapter's title gives you the story. So even those who are not directly related to the field of law, if they were to read the titles, these 20 chapters' titles, within the title, there is a good reflection of what is going to come in the chapter. By and large, if there was a bookshelf of 100 books on Pakistan's political history, this book would stand alone amongst them. I checked, I'm a person of the same field, political science, so I checked with also a few other colleagues. There is indeed hardly any which is on the same subject in the same breadth. I would therefore suggest to the author in particular and our other colleagues also that, like many other books, the launching should not be the climax of the book. In many cases, I have found, because there is so much redundancy, when a book is launched, that's the climax of it. Later on, there's very little discussion, very little even reading in many cases. In this case, this should be the beginning of that process. Each chapter and the information provided in every chapter can be discussed further. If there are people who dispute it, I'm sure those who've been, if not painted, or been described as having a lot of errors or a lot of bad consequences for history. And I should also say that at the end of each chapter, like a report card, the author gives an evaluation. It's typically about 3-4 lines, but that's like a report card on each of the Chief Justice. So those report cards, particularly by those who dispute them, but also who look at different aspects of it, in the law schools, in other professional places, including political science and political history people, that is from where the book should be taken up. And I would strongly recommend to the author, we were just discussing in the lounge that it's a very expensive book. Only about, I think, 1,500, 1,600, but much more expensive in writing. For people like other professors, including my colleague, Dr. Ijaz Hussain, if we go to a place and spend an hour or so, we typically will get about maximum at the National Defense University at the end a check of 5,000 rupees. But a lawyer, at the end of a arguing a case, we understand, collects much larger sums of money. So to be able to spend days and months, I would expect years in putting all of this hard work, because it's not just opinions, there's very, very thorough research in it. To put all of this work is a very expensive input by a serving lawyer. So this combination of practice and analysis, while on the one hand makes it expensive, also makes it very interesting. So that's the book. I hope many of you will read it and think about it. To begin that process, we have three very learned commentators today. All three of them from the field of law, both practitioners, a judge, and Dr. Ijaz Hussain, who's been a very eminent professor in this field. Again, one of the unique persons in our faculties of political science. We will begin with Mr. Faisal Siddiqui. We thought we will do it by age protocol. He happens to be the youngest. So we will begin with him. We will move on to, Dr. Saiba looks younger, but we will still give the honor to Dr. Ijaz Hussain as the second one. And then we will have Justice Nasira. Mr. Faisal Siddiqui is a very eminent lawyer. He's also worked for the government for a brief time. His company is very prominent. He's also been an author with us on a book in the last festival, which was on Chaudhary's court, his remarks all over wherever we went to introduce that book attracted a great deal of appreciation and attention. So Mr. Faisal Siddiqui, please. And you have about 8 to 10 minutes. I brought the watch, as you said.
Thank you, Jasab, and thank you for giving me this opportunity. If you broadly look at Hamid Khan Saab's book, then there are five, six elements which you notice about the book. The first element which Ijaz Saab has referred to is that it is really a rare book. It is really a unique book because it is quite shocking that there is no history of the judiciary which has been written in Pakistan or abroad. There is just no book. And I would also say this about his other book, The Constitutional and Political History of Pakistan, really something up to date. There is just no book. So if there is no reason, whether you like him or not, whether you like the book or not, really if you want to know about what has happened in the judiciary over since 47, or he begins before 47, his is the only material available. So that's the foremost reason to really have a look at the book. I think the second interesting thing about the book is that it is a macro history of the judiciary. It's a broad brush of judicial development. It's not about each and every case which the judiciary has decided. It's not about tax law. It's not about intellectual property. He gives you an overview of the entire judiciary and what are the basic trends in this judiciary. So that's the attractive thing in this book. If you look at the chapters, they are actually organized not in terms of subjects of the law, not really in terms of chronology, but really in terms of chief justices. And he's described the chief justices in a certain way, and really that is the description of the court and judicial philosophy of that period. So it is that broad brush history of the judiciary. The third thing about the book is that it is actually quite an enjoyable book to read. And it is really, even for non-lawyers, it's an accessible book. Of course, there is legal knowledge, there is a discussion on case law, major constitutional cases. But if you read the book, there is a lot of interesting judicial gossip, which is very important, of what these judges were doing. They were human beings, the wheelings and dealings which they were engaged into, their dissent and collaboration with the executive, and he's very bold about that, their personal failings. So it really reads like a judicial novel. It's not really a standard judicial history. You read it and you will enjoy it. The fourth thing is that even for a person like me, who's done a bit of reading on the judicial history in Pakistan, there's a lot of new information. And Hamid Saab has really worked hard on the book. You will see references of Dawn newspaper 1955. And most of the material which has been written, both primary and secondary material, which is on the history of the judiciary. A lot of interesting information. You will be able to understand why, among the high courts, why the Lahore High Court is passive and not really pro-government. Why is that? So Hamid Khan Saab gives you all this information and tries to explain to you that it has actually always been so from the very beginning. Of course, Justice Munir was one of those key judges who laid down this trend when he became the Chief Justice of the Lahore High Court. So a lot of information, but more importantly, and this is the key element of the book, that it helps you understand what is happening today, why the judiciary has revolted, why there is more dissent, why there is collaboration, why there is a pro-executive judiciary, why there are compromises in a historical context. I mean, these are not unusual acts which are taking place in 2016, 15, 14. There is a historical context behind. So he tells you, you'll be able to understand why something which the judges did in 2000, 99 by legitimizing martial law is something which is a long-term trend in the judiciary. So this historical perspective gives you those analytical tools to really understand what is going on, rather than having a talk show on TV, where judges are either condemned or praised, and there is no understanding that these judges are really part of a history, and maybe they are not in control, maybe they are not the persons making the decision. These are institutional trends in history. Another important element in the book is that it is actually a highly provocative book, and it is quite a courageous book. I mean, if you look at the chapters, I mean, a young lawyer like me, or at least a middle-aged lawyer like me, can't even think of labeling Chief Justices of the Supreme Court, Irshad Hasan Khan as the usurper supreme, usurper Chief Justice, or Riaz, Sheikh Riaz, as someone who was corrupt. We all know that, but Hamid Saab is in that unique position where he can actually say these things and then give you an argument to justify this. So a provocative book and a courageous book is always interesting to read, rather than a book which merely describes events. Now, in order to understand why Hamid Saab has written this book, you have to understand the author behind the book. Now, this is, Hamid Saab is actually quite a unique person in terms of his contemporary. I can't think of another lawyer like him. And I'm not praising him because he's invited me to this session. There is an argument behind it. The argument is that he's an unusual academic. He's an academic who's one of your leading lawyers, very successful private practice, who's aggressively fully involved in power politics, which is called lawyers' politics, who's involved in Pakistani politics, and who has, no one would deny it, has a very strong personality. And there are three elements of his personality which come out of this book. The first element is that a lot of people disagree with him, have very strong views against him, but nobody questions his integrity. I mean, I have yet to come across anyone who may disagree with him or disagree with his politics, but has questioned his integrity. He's a man of a very high level of integrity. A second element of his legal career has been that he's engaged in a lot of courageous acts. I mean, he stood before the Supreme Court, before Sheikh Riaz, and told the court to its face that we do not think that you are an independent court and we are withdrawing its petition. And the judges had really had to threaten him with contempt, and then all they could do is withdraw his status as a senior advocate. So, I mean, he's not the person who, because these judges are no more on the bench, that is why he's saying what he's saying. He's always said that. He's always taken that risk. So, out of this element of a person who is involved in day-to-day legal practice, someone who's aggressively involved in bar politics, someone who's politically active, and someone who has this strong personality, this, out of this comes this very unusual academic book, which is, I think that is why it's interesting to read. It is informative. It says things which usually academics would not say. Are there any problems with the book? Of course, every book has problems. I think one of the criticisms which will be labeled against this book would be that it doesn't cover everything. So it doesn't cover every aspect of judicial history, or it doesn't talk about all the major judges and what they did. I think this book is not really about a history of the judiciary in its totality. It is really a book about, and if you read the preface, you will understand this, it is really a book about a history of judicial independence. It focuses on the issue of judicial independence and then really analyzes events, judges, and cases to look at judicial. Of course, judicial independence is not the only thing about judicial history, but really its focus is on judicial independence. And within that notion of judicial independence, what it focuses on is the relationship of collaboration and dissent between the judiciary and the executive. So it's a wrong criticism on the book to say that it doesn't cover. Really, you should read it as a book about what has happened to judicial independence over this long period of judicial history. I think a more valid criticism of this book could be about its reading of judicial history. Now, let's take one example, and with due respect to Mr. Khan, I know Colinius is his hero, but a lot of people will doubt the fact whether Colinius' period can be labeled as the golden years. Now, we condemn Munir, but we must remember that Colinius also legitimized martial law in Dosso. For 12 years, there was no questioning of Ayub Khan by him. Ayub Khan started appointing, and these are things which are mentioned in the book, started appointing judges himself, and that was really a humiliating process. There was no real decision making there. It was really to tell the judges that I am in charge, I am appointing you. And the culmination of that is Colinius joining Yahya Khan. And really, I mean, he was the main constitutional advisor of Yahya Khan at the time of the fall of East Pakistan. Now, I don't see this as simple mistakes by Colinius. I think Colinius, Munir were part of what I called the judges who had a colonial mindset. These were judges who were basically anti-democratic. These were judges who did not believe in constitutional democracy. They believed in a very limited notion of the rule of law, and they believed in a very limited notion of constitutionalism. And that is where the interesting question about Pakistani judicial history occurs, that if you compare Colinius with one of the devils which Hamid Khan identifies as Shah Hasan Khan, the usurper chief justice. Actually, Zafar Ali Shah's judgment is the boldest judgment when it comes to questioning martial law. Because the restrictions imposed by the Zafar Ali Shah judgment are actually not imposed in the Nusrat Bhutto judgment. And really, it is a much step ahead from Colinius' separate note in 58. So people can question whether what is a golden period. And the question which arises out of this, really, is that the problem with Pakistan's judicial history has been that you have great judges, great people doing very bad things, legitimizing martial law. And you have rascals, really, scoundrels as judges, actually producing judgments in favor of democracy. So how do you explain this? This is the paradox of Pakistan's judicial history. One last thing. I think a very good chapter in this book, and something I think Mr. Khan could not develop on, but it's a very important chapter that after really analyzing the entire judicial history, he talks about trends in the judiciary and he identifies these multiple trends. I think certain important trends are missed out. One is that I think there is a trend, a continuing trend of judicial dissent, which is now developing in Pakistan. I don't think it is now reversible. This conflict between the judiciary and executive will not go into reverse gear, it will only increase. You will have more judges dissenting, you will have more judicial, and this will not be dependent on whether the judge is a scoundrel or a gentleman like Colinius. It is a historical process. A second trend, which I think is a very important trend, which will feed into this trend, is the judicialization of state and societal issues. Really, the judiciary has now emerged as an alternative to the state. And I don't think that is going to be reversed either by a civilian or a martial law regime. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our second commentator would be Dr. Ijaz Hussain, who is a PhD in international law, a professor, then dean at the Qaid-e-Azam University, author of several books. Dr. Ijaz Hussain, please.
Thank you. Dr. Sahab, I must say that my job is more difficult than yours or my other predecessor, because I have known Hamid Khan for the last more than, it would tell my age, you know, but anyhow, I have to say more than 60 years. So it's a somewhat of a difficult job, because whereas I am obviously going to praise him, but in the Shakespearean terminology, bury him at the same time, you know. So it is a, I'll be doing a hatchet job at the same time. We know that that the judicial history has been very checkered, you know. Judiciary has been very checkered in Pakistan. Now consider the following. For example, it acted as an accomplice of an unscrupulous ruler to subvert the constitution by sending the constituent assembly home. It supported the man, always supported the man on the horseback, who, whenever he came forward claiming to be the messiah of the nation, unfairly sent an elected prime minister to the gallows and another one home. It is true that it was subjected to physical assault by the executive when it tried to confront that executive. But it also stood up against a bullying tyrant by refusing to accept his dictate. Now, notwithstanding this judicial odyssey, which has the roller coaster-like quality, not much, it is amazing, you know, that not much has been written on the subject. And whatever exists, in the words of Hamid Khan, it is unreliable and inadequate. So he justifies the present study on the ground that it is an organized study, firstly, and secondly, that it has attained a very high profile. I think it is important to mention that Hamid Khan, I'm repeating it, what earlier has been said, that Hamid Khan is an author of an earlier monumental study, Constitutional and Political History of Pakistan, which considerably covers the area that the present book covers, you know. But he justifies the present study on the ground that there are sufficient reasons and enough material to write a separate study on the history of the judiciary of Pakistan. And I think it would have been better if he had elaborated it. Why another book, you know, while you have written one which covers almost the same ground, at least considerably covers the same ground. I just skip out the contents of the book, you know, because it has already been mentioned here, so there is no need to repeat it. Let us look at the approach that Hamid Khan adopts, you know. It is a no holds barred approach. He is making frank and forthright comments on various events and personalities. For Hamid Khan, there are no sacred cows, and friends and foes are treated alike without any partiality. However, it must be said to his credit that while doing so, he is objective, fair and balanced in his approach. I think this is a very hard task for him, because he has been associated, very closely associated with the bar politics, and he has been heading the professional group, taking part in elections at the provincial and the national level, and also he is a senior member of the PTI. I am mentioning these things because, you know, that generates bad blood, creates enmities, and some of the lawyers with whom he interacts and against he speaks at the bar, you know, some of them, they go on to sit on the bench. So speaking very forthrightly is a very difficult task for a person like him, who has to live with them. Now, an example of a previous example of of his fairness and objectivity, we take the case of the Chief Justice Munir, you know. Whereas Hamid Khan thinks that the Dosso case, where he justified, where Munir justified martial law, he considered it as an original sin, because, to quote him, because the bedrock for an enduring yet dubious relationship between the judiciary and the dictators, military or otherwise, you know. It established that liaison, that relationship between the judiciary and the dictators, whether military or civil. But at the same time, he doesn't lose his balance. He profusely praises Munir for writing some of the most outstanding judgment, which in his opinion became foundational in nature in laying down Pakistan's liberal jurisprudence. You see how balanced he is, whereas he criticizes him for the Dosso case and also for Maulvi Tamizuddin Khan case, you know, but at the same time, he is full of praise for him. Another example, I think more contemporary example, is that of his observations regarding the Chief Justice Irshad Hassan Khan. He describes him as a rank opportunist because he was complicit with Musharraf in validating his coup d'etat and also gave him carte blanche to do whatever he liked and to rule the country for 3 years. But at the same time, he accuses him of fraudulent referendum and rigged general election. But again, here, where he is his bête noire, as they say it in French, you know, he severely criticizes him. He at the same time says that he was a very hardworking judge and laborious in judge writing. He further describes him as a willing writer, an intelligent and sharp person who would readily reach the essential of a proposition in a case. Let's take another example. That is of, again, one of his contemporaries, Sheikh Riaz Ahmed, who succeeded Irshad Asad Khan as the CJP. Even though he paints him as a patron saint of corruption and graft, this is what he says about him. But at the same time, he's honest enough to recognize that Sheikh Riaz was a simple man who was never pompous, extravagant, or ostentatious. I'm quoting from his book, you know. There is a need to understand what is the central approach of Hamid Khan to really understand what he's writing. What I have discovered is that Hamid Khan adopts the Freudian psychoanalytical approach in comprehending the judicial history of Pakistan. What does that mean, you know? We know that Freud believed that psychological problems from which an adult suffers are rooted in his infancy. And it is going there that you will understand and also find solutions, you know. Similarly, Hamid Khan believes that the good, bad, and the ugly of the Pakistan judiciary is better explained through an examination of its experiences in its infancy. Let's take examples, you know. To begin with, he credits the first Chief Justice of Pakistan, Sir Abdul Rashid, for laying down the basis of an independent judiciary. Similarly, he credits Chief Justice A.R. Cornelius for introducing stability and liberal laws in Pakistan. As opposed to them, he blames Justice Munir for derailing the constitution and judiciary through his judgment in Maulvi Tamizuddin Khan case and also in the Dosso case, you know. Commenting on these judgments, he observes that they set a bad precedent for the judiciary and became the precursors of similar judgments in the future. Incidentally, this is not much known, you know, but he brings out a very interesting fact. He says, incidentally, the nepotism in the judiciary is also to be traced to the early years of Judiciary of Pakistan. When Ghulam Muhammad, he says, when Ghulam Muhammad, through a clever maneuvering, appointed Chief Justice Munir as the Chief Justice of Pakistan over Justice Akram from Bengal. Let me explain it a little bit. You know, the Justice Akram from Bengal, he was from East Pakistan. He was a senior most. He deserved to be the Chief Justice of Pakistan. But Ghulam Muhammad did the nepotism, and he appointed instead another Kakezai, because he was a Kakezai, and appointed another Kakezai, which was this gentleman Munir, and he just ignored Justice Akram from Bengal. If you allow me another 2 minutes, I'll just wind it up. He has chronicled the judiciary's movement, which I'm not going to go into. Just I want to say that there were some people who became the public face, like Ijaz Ehsan, Ali Ahmed Kur, then Munir Malik. Of course, they made a lot of contribution in this movement, you know. But there was one gentleman who remained in the background, and who was the real mastermind of that movement. It was none other than Hamid Khan, who masterminded that movement, you know. But he remained in the background, never sought publicity. I know him from closely, that he's a very self-effacing and unassuming person, and never tried to market himself during that period. And that also comes out in this book. He never tried, he is not trying to take credit on that score. One final point, just half a minute, that Hamid Khan, the book covers up till 2009, till the restoration of the period. We are now in 2016, you know. I think this is a huge gap, huge lapse. This period should have been covered, but it doesn't cover, because very momentous events took place during this period. I'm not going to go into the details. Only God and Hamid Khan knows why this has been done. I'm not so sure. God must be very busy with his own things, you know. Hamid Khan should know it, and I think he needs to explain why he has left out such an important period in this book. Thank you very much.
Our third and last commentator is Justice Nasir Iqbal, who is very prominent public figure. And I should say has earned that public role for herself. She comes from a very prominent family of Dr. Muhammad Iqbal and Dr. Javed Iqbal, but very quietly and slowly and with patience and effort, she has created her own role as a person with eminence and knowledge and the effort to play a public role. So, Justice Nasir Iqbal, we are sorry the book was given to her only yesterday. We had another speaker earlier in the list, and she very kindly consented to be the commentator here. So, apologies for that.
Thank you very much. And I'm very happy to see that there are a number of members of the legal fraternity here. There should have been more, because I think that this particular book, which I've really just skimmed through, is a very important contribution to the history of the judiciary. And I would say it's not wrong to say that this is the most organized book on the history of the judiciary. There have been books written earlier. In fact, Benazir's minister also, who now claimed a PhD on that book, also ventured to write a book full of all kinds of personal opinions, in which respect I think Hamid Khan has been very dispassionate. And he has also couched his book and his whatever he has mentioned about the different chief justices in very temperate language, and avoided being hit by the law of contempt of court, which is, I think, a very valuable thing that he has done, because this now seems to be a trend. Anybody who tries to raise their voice, of course, the judges have the opportunity of pinning them under the contempt of court. I must say that Hamid Khan has not only been an asset to the legal profession, but also to the development of legal practice in Pakistan, and also partly to the political development of Pakistan. And in this respect, he has played a role which is similar to that of Iqbal, who was a lawyer, and he gave the vision of Pakistan. Qaid-e-Azam was the lawyer who led the movement for the freedom of Pakistan with so many other lawyers, all the important persons in the history of the Pakistan movement were lawyers. And even though I think that though Hamid Khan did not aspire to become a member of the judiciary, he would have been a valuable asset and would have, of course, risen to the level of Chief Justice, but that would have been a loss to the bar and the civil society of Pakistan. So his remaining with us, I think, has been one of his invaluable contributions. I'm glad most things about the book have already been said by my predecessors who were talking here, because I have really not had much chance to go into the detail of what he had written. But I very strongly share his views about Munir, and I think I feel more strongly that if Munir had not been appointed Chief Justice instead of Akram, the history of Pakistan's constitutional history would have been different. Maybe we would have been spared so many repeated abrogations of the constitution. But the unfortunate part is that the doctrine of legitimate expectancy had not been introduced at that time, which later on laid down this principle that the senior most judge of the High Court and the Supreme Court is entitled to be the Chief Justice and should be announced so a period before, a little time before the Chief Justice goes out, so that he can sort of step into his shoes with ease. But some of the shoes, I very much agree with Mr. Hamid Khan, did not need to be stepped into. In fact, it was better that nobody stepped into the shoes of Justice Riaz or Justice Yaqub Ali and Justice Irshad Hassan Khan, who was rightly termed as an opportunist. We could also have done without him. And if the same Sayyid Usman Siddiqui court had remained, things would have been much different. But that is the tragedy of history, that opportunists take the opportunity by the horns, and those who have better values, particularly in our judicial history, have not remained steadfast to their principles. Sometimes they make a mini compromise, and later on they try to adjust, as in the case of Sayyiduzzaman Siddiqui was mentioned in the book. But it is unfortunate that these things do happen. And the fact that the judiciary attained a high profile with the removal of Iftikhar Chaudhry, the movement, the lawyers' movement, rightly pointed out, one of our leaders was Mr. Hamid Khan, though he did it very quietly and not with a high profile, though many others even used that as an opportunity to raise a very high profile. But that movement, I think, was a remarkable movement. It was a peaceful movement which led to the restoration of democracy, the independence of the rule of law, and the revival of the judiciary. And it had set down certain values that it is most unlikely that the military will again assume on themselves the task of usurper. And I think that has been the most valuable contribution of this particular movement, which was spearheaded by Mr. Hamid Khan. And he rightly pointed out that the judgments that he has cited of the different courts, the Chief Justices, they reflect on the quality of the temperament and the integrity of the judges themselves. And as he rightly pointed out, some of them have written autobiographies or their biographies have been written, but many of them have been self-exculpatory and had not really provided any material for him. And I think he has done a great deal of research while he was writing this book. And it very much complements his previous book, which was a history of the political and constitutional history of Pakistan, which I read in depth. And I think it has been used as a textbook by many people. And this particular book, I think it should be used as a textbook in all law colleges, because it has a very valuable insight into how the court developed from Rashid till the present situation. And this present situation is very much amorphous and ambiguous, because the Chief Justices have come for 2-3 months at a time, so no one has been able to leave a serious imprint. But now when we have a judge, Chief Justice, who may be there for 5 years, we will find out and discover how he molds the Supreme Court. And if he reads this book first, I think it will give him some food for thought as to how he should behave or conduct himself in running the chief, the Supreme Court of Pakistan. And he has rightly said that the temperament and the judgments of the Chief Justice of the court, they trickle down right to the district courts and the lowest, the subordinate judiciary, because they can't lay down the law. They follow the law which is laid down by the Supreme Court. And if the judges of the superior courts ask favors of the lower courts, then obviously it gives them an opportunity to act with rank corruption and behave in a manner which is unseemly. So it is really, I think, a very fair comment. All the subordinate judiciaries should also read this book, and in fact it should be prescribed as a text in the judicial academies. They don't have any prescribed text so far, and we have provincial judicial academies and we have the federal judicial academy, which would do well by prescribing this book. And he has rightly praised Cornelius for his giving stability to the court. And I find that even there may be dissent with this book, but there's dissent with everything that anyone says. And of course, we need a follow-up. The Islamabad High Court developed after this book was written. Many things to be said about that court. And also, I think, a chapter about the conduct of lawyers. You know, this is now a very heavily oversubscribed profession. And the conduct of the lawyers in the past 5 years since the restoration of the Iftikhar Chaudhary Court leaves much to be desired. And they are the aspiring judges. And they go out of their way to try and, you know, raise themselves in the favor of the Chief Justices because they think that's the way. So those two things maybe could be the subject of his next book. And I really do compliment him on this hard work and all the research he has done. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Dr. Sahib, I have a great advice that all students who have learned clauses of law, and also the law story of law, also need to learn. Dr. Ijaz Hussain is saying that many results are emerged from the story. Clauses में emerge करने के अलावा तो question answers के लिए या observations के लिए भी मुख्तसर हो तो अच्छे हैं. खातून मुझे कह रही हैं सिर्फ 15 मिनट रह गए हैं, लेकिन 15 मिनट काफी होते हैं. आपसे नौजवान से शुरू कर लें, फिर हम seniors पे आएंगे. जी, author आज भी उन्होंने कहा कि मैं आखिर में सिर्फ शुक्रिया अदा करूंगा. तो लेकिन यह है कि इसके बाद मैंने उन्हें मशवरा दिया कि conclusion में 10 items हैं, जिसमें से बहुत से कोर्ट के लिए और वकीलों के लिए, कि उन्हें 10 लेक्चर्स देने चाहिए फिर. लेकिन आज ऑथर ने कहा है कि मैं सिर्फ शुक्रिया अदा करूंगा. आप
सो देयर इज अ परसेप्शन दैट जुडिशरी हैज बिकम वेरी इंडिपेंडेंट आफ्टर द हिस्टोरिक लॉयर्स मूवमेंट, बट इट हैज नॉट बीन एबल टू मेक इटसेल्फ इंडिपेंडेंट फ्रॉम द बायसेस. देयर माइट बी पॉलिटिकल सोशल बायसेस. इफ दैट इज ट्रू, what is the way forward? Does the problem lie in the appointment of the judiciary, or the 18th amendment has solved that problem?
Aur shukriya, hum ke comments pehle le lete hain. Aap
aur iski ek sarsari sa jaisa liya hai, no doubt ke ye ek tribute hai aur compliment hai lawyers ki movement ko bhi, aur jo unki struggle for the restoration of independence of judiciary, supremacy of constitution and rule of law. Lekin isme ek cheez jo main missing sarsari nazar se dekh, isme ek important sabse jo thi wo Kelsen theory thi, jo doctrine of necessity thi. Uska zikr in between lines mujhe us tarah se strongly nahi mila hai jiski hum aap se tawqqo karte the. Number one. Number two, do you think that this theory has been ever buried after the judgment of the Sindh High Court Bar Association?
बहुत शुक्रिया. इसके जवाब हामिद साहब देंगे, लेकिन उन्होंने कैल्सन का काफ़ी जिक्र है बीच बीच में लाइनों में, लेकिन बहुत मरतबा 8-10 मरतबा शायद दिया है, लेकिन है लाइनों में. तो हामिद साहब खुद से बयान करेंगे. कोई पीछे से? जी, खातून यहाँ से.
I want to ask a question from
next to Nidhi.
This is Nasir. I am Secretary General of Islamabad High Court, and of course I want to know something that Justice Munir didn't belong to our court, and you had certain reservations about our court. You have said that Islamabad High Court. I would like to know your views, small views about my court. I would like.
Say, Shelly.
Assalamualaikum. In writing the history of the existing judiciary, I was wondering if there's a history of the absence of female judiciary, or particularly at the higher levels. So if there are any comments or insights you have into that, that would be interesting to hear.
Green shirt, Rooch.
Thank you. My question is from Faisal Siddiqui. You speak about the judicialization of Pakistani state and society and how it is difficult to roll back the judicial independence that has come in recent years. How do you make the connect between judicialization and the probable consolidation of democracy in Pakistan? Is there a link? Thank you.
Maybe one more observation. Because बहुत ख़ाशबंद है हाथ भी खड़ा किया नहीं हो सके और अगर नहीं तो फिर मैं ख्याल है कि फैसल सिद्दीकी साहब से शुरू कर लेता हूँ
I think judicialization is a worldwide trend. It's a global trend. You look at the courts in Europe, you look at the courts in Latin America, you look at the South Asian courts. In every, really every jurisdiction, you have more and more state and societal issues being judicialized, being solved by the judiciary. So what happened in Pakistan in the 21st century is part of a global trend. What happened, what Afzalullah did in 89 was not something which came out of a vacuum. It came out of a global trend. It was happening in India, it was happening all over. Now, there is of course a relationship between judicialization and the consolidation of the democratic process. One obvious connection is that judicialization occurs through the application of the constitution. And a necessary part of the constitution is constitutional democracy. But what is happening in Pakistan is that there is now a competition, not simply between judicialization and militarization, but judicialization and democratization. And out of that contradiction, problems will occur both for the judiciary as well as for democracy. So these are two trends. They are also in harmony with each other as well as in conflict with each other.
Military is not an option. Aap ji kahen is triangle mein.
Aap ji sir, do sawal mujhse hain. Ek to ye hai ki females ko kyun nahi laaye Supreme Court. This is a very pertinent and a relevant question, particularly today when there are vacancies to be filled. This is a male-dominated discipline. The discipline of law, and the law colleges in Pakistan were not open to females till 1960 plus. That's why the number of females who have come into the legal profession are limited, but now they are being more and more since 1994 when the first female judges were inducted. But there are examples of women who have been overlooked, like Khalda Rashid from the Peshawar High Court, a very competent judge who was sent to the International Tribunal on Rwanda and later on now about Bosnia, etc. And she was told that your staying back will not give you an opportunity to become the CJ of the KPK court or to go to the Supreme Court, both which things she was rightfully entitled to. Then we have Fakhrunnisa Khokar from our court who was also not given the opportunity. And this is something that women have to take up seriously, write about it in the newspapers, and there have been things appearing in the press and I have seen them. But I think we need to be more aggressive about it, because unless there is a female in the Supreme Court, there is no empathy with half the population, 48% to be precise. They are not represented. And the judiciary is supposed to be the least dangerous branch of the three pillars of the state. And therefore, there's an urgent need that women should be represented. The other question was about the Islamabad High Court. I'm sorry, that comment maybe was uncalled for, and probably Mr. Hamid Khan may not be the appropriate person to write a book about it. Maybe you should write about it. This is a fledgling High Court, the Islamabad High Court. And it's time now that somebody did write something about it to point out what are the advantages of this court and what are the disadvantages. And that comment was not meant to be unfavorable. But sometimes, you see, the judges speak through their judgments. The Supreme Court effectively gave their judgment on the judgment of the Islamabad High Court in a very recent, very controversial case, which concluded in a very controversial occurrence, which was furtherly exploited by a controversial segment of society. But these things should be taken into cognizance more carefully by the judges of the initial superior courts, and maybe you would be able to write a critical analysis because you are right there. But I'm sorry I put that responsibility on Hamid.
Ghanti aapke gale mein pahunch gayi. Dr. Saab, I think I should finally turn to...
I didn't come under any assault, physical or otherwise.
Dr. Saab, bachpan ke dost hain pehle hi, begum bhi saath aayi hui hain, do bhi iski testimony de rahi hain. So, ki bachpan ke dost hain, to uske bawajood sabse zyada criticism bachpan ke dost ne hi kiya hai.
Ye bhi baat kaha tha ki mere liye bada mushkil hai.
Sahi, usi dosti ka hi koi dhyan aap kar lete. Lekin iska matlab ye hai ki hum baaki aap jab zara usme universityon mein ya colleges mein Hamid Khan saab ke guftagu rakhein, तो उसमें डॉक्टर इजाज़ हुसैन वैसे ये जो आगे करने की चीज़ें हैं उस पर ज़रूर बोली. और मेरा ख्याल है कि जज साहब की ये बात बिल्कुल दुरुस्त है कि इसे लॉ कॉलेजेस में, मेरा ख्याल है पॉलिटिकल साइंस डिपार्टमेंट्स में भी, और जो लॉ से रिलेटेड अकेडमीज़ हैं उनके करिकुलम में होने चाहिए. और वैसे जो सिटिंग जजेस हैं वो भी इसे गौर से पढ़ें तो ये काफ़ी मुफीद हो सकता है. अगर मैं ऑक्सफोर्ड यूनिवर्सिटी प्रेस की जगह होता तो उनमें से बहुत से को तोहफे के तौर पे ये भेजता उनके अपने लिए हर जगह में. जैसे आज हामिद खान साहब कर रहे हैं, कल कोई और इसी तरह से हिस्ट्री क्या कहती है वो उनके बारे में बयान करेगी, तो इसलिए उनके पढ़ा हो तो अच्छा है. मैं आखिर में हामिद खान साहब को दावत देता हूँ कि हामिद खान साहब वो उनके पास जितना भी वक्त है और कहना चाहें, इतने उन्होंने कई साल लगे होंगे, कितना अर्सा खान साहब इसको, काफ़ी कई साल, आप कुछ इस बारे में बताएं कि अच्छी किताब लिखी कैसे जाती है. हामिद खान साहब
जी, इजाज़ गिलानी साहब और डॉक्टर इजाज़ हुसैन साहब, मोहतरमा नासरा इकबाल साहबा, जनाब फैसल सिद्दीकी साहब, और आप सबका मैं ममनून हूँ कि आप तशरीफ़ लाए इस मौके पर. और मेरी एक बड़ी ही हम्बल सी कंट्रीब्यूशन को सराहा और बहुत अच्छे मशवरे भी दिए. मैं आपका शुक्रिया अदा करना चाहता हूँ. दो तीन बातें जो आज की डिस्कशन से वो मैं एक्सप्लेन करता जाऊँ. एक बात तो फैसल सिद्दीकी साहब ने ये कही कि ट्रेंड्स का जिक्र करते हुए, वो ट्रेंड जो आजकल इमर्ज हो रहा है वो ट्रेंड है कि डिसेंटिंग ओपिनियन दी जाए, जो कि एक बहुत अहम चीज़ है जो हमारी अदलिया की तारीख में मिसिंग है. और हमने आम तौर पर डिसेंटिंग ओपिनियंस नहीं लिखी, एक्सेप्ट फॉर दी फेमस कॉर्नीलियस ओपिनियन इन मौलवी तमीज़ुद्दीन खान्स केस. तो ये ट्रेंड एक्चुअली, ये मैंने किताब कंक्लूड कर दी थी मार्च 2009 में, और इसका मसवदा मैं 2010 में तैयार करके ऑक्सफोर्ड यूनिवर्सिटी प्रेस को भेज दिया था. ये उनकी बड़ी मेहरबानी है कि उन्होंने इस पर 5 साल सर्व किए इसको छापने में. गालिबन इस किताब की प्रायोरिटी वो नहीं थी जो कि शायद और किताबों की होती है. डल एंड ड्राई टॉपिक होने की वजह से होगा या क्या वजह थी. बहरहाल हर 6 महीने के बाद मुझे ये पता चलता था कि अभी इसमें मजीद कोई पजीराई नहीं हुई है कोई, तो एक वजह ये हो गई जो जिसका इन्होंने ज़िक्र किया है. तो अगर आज की तारीख में लिखा जाए तो एक ट्रेंड ज़रूर शुरू हो गया है डिसेंटिंग ओपिनियन का, जिसकी बुनियाद रखी गई है जो ये रिसेंट जजमेंट आई है 21वीं तरमीम पर, जिसमें 11-6 डिसेंट आई है, जो कि मैं समझता हूँ एक तारीखी इत्तदा है कि डिसेंटिंग ओपिनियन इतने तादाद में लिखी जाए. तो बिल्कुल सही है फैसल, ये अगले दफ़ा जब इनको कवर किया जाएगा तो इस ट्रेंड की तरफ ज़रूर. अभी भी वहाँ नहीं पहुँचा जहाँ पर हिंदुस्तान में या अमेरिका में तो इंथाक है, वो है अभी तक वहाँ नहीं पहुँचे। और ये बात मैंने ये बात ज़िमनन कर दी थी कि 2010 में मुसवदा कंप्लीट होने के बाद 2016 में ये काविश आपके सामने आई, उसकी वजह मैंने एक्सप्लेन कर दी। वरना यकीनी तौर पर जो चौधरी साहब का दूसरा एरिया है फ्रॉम मार्च 2009 से दिसंबर 2013 तक, ये बहुत अहमियत का हामिल है क्योंकि इसी में बहुत सारी डेवलपमेंट हुई है। लेकिन उसके लिए मैं समझता हूँ सेकंड एडिशन में अगर मुझे मौका मिला तो उसको मैं डिस्कस करूँगा। एक बात जो शेख साहब ने की है, शेख आसमुद्दीन साहब ने, मेरे कुलीग हैं, एक्स प्रेसिडेंट हैं पिंडी बार हाईकोर्ट बार एसोसिएशन रावलपिंडी के, कि कैल्सन थियरी का, कैल्सन थियरी का जिक्र तो किया है जहाँ जिक्र हुआ डोसो केस का, लेकिन जो खुशायंद बात है वो ये है कि इसको रिजेक्ट कर दिया था उसके 1972 में आसमा जिलानी वाले केस में। और जब तीसरी दफ़ा इसका मामला सामने आया वो था बेगम रुसत भुट्टो वाले केस में, उसमें भी उस अदालत ने उसको रिजेक्ट किया, उन्होंने सहारा लिया है डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ नेसेसिटी का। अब मसला ये है कैल्सन थ्योरी तो अपनी मौत मर गई है, लेकिन क्या ये डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ नेसेसिटी भी अपने वक्त में अपने इख्तदाम को पहुँचेगी, ये जुडिशरी के सामने बहुत बड़ा चैलेंज है। हम उम्मीद रखते हैं कि फिर आइंदा से कभी डॉक्टर ऑफ नेसेसिटी रिज़र्व नहीं होगा। मैं आप सबका बहुत ममनून हूँ।